Welcome back, I'm Ryan from Blue Gaming, and I'm currently on top of Mont Blanc, or not actually, I'm just in the game of Steep. Now, this is going to be a somewhat review of Steep. This is one of the few times I'm actually doing a live review of me actually playing it at the same time as reviewing it. Let's just get right into this. Let's start out by saying I completely overlooked this game for the longest time. You will see, even if you were to go back and look at my video for E3, that I pretty much just completely shat all over this game. I didn't like what this game was doing. I didn't like the always online DRM, which I still don't like, but we'll get to that. I just thought that there was no real reason why this game should be made, or that anybody would actually enjoy playing this. And then the beta came out, the little free weekend beta that they had for all of 3 days came out, and I played that for a bit. I ended up hating it after about an hour, and then I stopped playing it. Then the next day, something really weird happened. I got an urge to play it again. And this urge was so strong that I even re-downloaded it after deleting it the previous day, and continued to play it for 5 hours. I don't know what it is about this game, but it's just calming and fun. Mostly for the snowboarding for me. I used to play a series of games called SSX on the PlayStation 2, and this is about the closest thing that we've gotten to that in a long time. And the SSX game that came out on the 360 and PS3, that game was shit and doesn't actually exist. So, yeah, I don't know. I've just had a little want to play a snowboarding game that was actually kind of good. So, most of what I've played so far is snowboarding, but I have played enough of the other types of traversal items that they have in this game to actually give a full review. So, let's just start off with the beginning. Let's start out with the main thing that's really bad with this. Let's just, start with the negatives. First, huge negative, you have to be connected to the Ubisoft servers. This is really, there's no need to have, any sort of DRM in this game, but they have it, and you have to always be online, or else you can't play this, which, I don't know, kinda sucks, because that means that there will come a point when this game just won't work anymore, and that's whenever they decide to shut off the servers, because it doesn't look like it's actually a peer-to-peer connection. It is, dedicated servers, so whenever they decide, hey, we're going to shut off the servers, that's whenever this game just dies. And we don't know if that's a year from now, 2 years from now, or a month from now. And it looks to be sooner rather than later with the amount of copies that this game sold. So, I don't know. Realistically, I'm going to guess 5 years or so that the servers are going to be up on this game, but really, it's anybody's guess, and I don't even think Ubisoft knows when they're going to shut off the servers for this game. So that is one problem. If you're seeing this video like a few years from when it was originally put up, you might want to check to see the status of the servers in this game. The next big issue that I have with this game, and essentially there's not really many more negatives after this, but do you see that G-force gauge over on the left of my character? Whenever I land a trick, it will occasionally pop up. If I land a trick incorrectly, it will pop up. that is pretty much, once that gauge goes all the way down, let me get to a spot where I can actually get it to kind of move a little bit. Okay, so, should move a little bit here. But once this gauge, the G-force gauge, once it falls all the way out to the bottom, which is somewhere around 10.5 or so G's, I don't know the exact number, and it doesn't display the exact number of when you max out the G gauge. But whenever that gets maxed out, you fall off your board, and that is super annoying, as you can see right there. 15.5 G's was enough to set off. Now, this does play into the realistic nature of this, but I feel like this game would benefit a lot from not having that G-gauge, as landing some very minor tricks with your board just pointed a little bit of the wrong way can cause you to have some major G-force damage, or however you want to call it. But, yeah, I really wish that just wasn't there, because then you could get some... it would lead to there being higher... people getting higher point streaks, but I feel like that's something that this game really needs. The rest of it, though, does lend to the realistic part of this, and that's just supposed to add to the realism, but really this game can do well without it. Now, to the final negative, we have to go here into the options, and specifically, the shop. There's microtransactions in this game. Let me just skip past that, I didn't mean to click this. Nope. There's microtransactions in this game, as I was saying. It's for steep credits. Well, what do steep credits get you? Let's go over to my writer. As you can see, up in the top corner, I have 132,750 steep credits. I got all of those without paying a single cent. So, just to show you the amount that you can kind of get. Now, what do steep credits get you? Well, say you want this jacket, that'll cost you 4,000 steep credits. Say you want this jacket, 2,800. It's essentially like this for quite a bit of items. You can either unlock them by doing challenges. As you can see, this North Face jacket, you have to complete the North Face expedition. Then there's other ones like complete challenges and such. You get some just for being in the Ubisoft Club and stuff like that. All these other ones down here are by unlocking challenges, but some of these you have to use credits for. Now, I picked an outfit early on that I liked, this X-ray outfit, so I didn't have to spend my credits. But if you want to buy quite a bit of these items, then you might have to buy some credits. And as we can just go through here, you can see that some of these are a little bit more expensive than others, like that clown helmet, 18,000 credits. This caribou helmet, 12,000 credits. Just a simple pair of headphones, 2,000 credits. Some of these things can be a bit more expensive than others. And while I don't think that you'll have to use any of these steep credit packs, I'm just going in to see how much they cost, because this could be really ridiculous. These, as you can see, it goes anywhere from $5 to $50. Let's just see how much is in this. 260,000 steep credits. 260,000 steep credits. That means that I have, let's see how little, 20,000 steep credits for $5. As you can see, that can get a little ridiculous. I have 132,000 credits, so that means that I have about $30 worth, $25-$30 worth of steep credits, and that is just ridiculous. As you can see, some different things here. Yeah, that's pretty ridiculous. And some other things, like you can buy helicopter tickets with steep credits, even though once you reach level 25, you get an infinite number. Yeah, this game really didn't need, this game did not need, the microtransactions. But that is it for the negatives, so let's get into the positives. Starting out with this, the rider customization. There is pretty extensive rider customization. As you can see, these are all, you wear some of these during, when you're actually, like, snowboarding or skiing. What you're seeing right there is the wingsuit, which I have an outfit on, this, vampire costume. My regular snowboard is using this X-ray costume. They have a wide variety of costumes, too. There was a Yeti costume. If you play during Christmas, which I don't know if you can get this anymore, but if you play during Christmas, then there's this Santa costume, which, yes, my rider's head is now an animal. But let's not dwindle on that. You got, like, crash test dummies, unicorns. This one's specifically named Eleanor the Unicorn. Bunnies, tigers, giraffes, cows, bees. It's a pretty wide variety. They get a little lazy here with just the glow stuff. But it's a pretty wide variety of different things that you can put on. I wish that there was a little bit more, range in the helmets and the different headgear, but not really too much of a concern. I also like the large amount of skis and snowboards and wingsuits that they actually have available. The one thing that I'm just disappointed on is they don't have any, like, super wacky designs. I don't know, that's just something that that I brought over from SSX. Every time that I play game like snowboarding or skating or something, I just want something that makes my character super wacky, and that's not really displayed in the boards. Now there's also wingsuits that you can customize, which I'll get into each of these individually here in a bit, but there's wingsuits that you can customize. As you can see, I'm wearing the vampire outfit, so that's what my wingsuit looks like. But you have other ones that are, like, thin like this. You have the bigger, older ones. Just a whole bunch of different designs and stuff. So pretty much you can customize your guy however you want. Then there's paragliding canopies. Because it's close to New Year's, I have this. There's a okay kind of variety in this. They really don't have enough variety in the wingsuits and the paragliding canopies, but they also don't have enough parachute canopies either. This is kind of a little bit of a letdown, but there's enough that you can change it however you want. Then you can also just add on different things like these patches and stuff. You can see them on your character and such, and all of this is amazing customization that you don't really get in very many other games. The most other customization in an extreme sports game like this came from Skate, the Skate games that they haven't made in a long time. The customization in that wasn't even as good as the customization in this. Kind of helps that this game has three different outfits that you wear, but yeah, it's just, this game has amazing customization. So let's get into actually the four different ways to, five kind of, traverse around the mountain. Let's start with the walking. Walking will get you pretty much anywhere very slowly. Walking is pretty much the only way to go back up a mountain, unless you were to teleport using the mountain view, which I'll get to here in a minute. But walking goes always at this speed. Doesn't matter if you're in really little snow, a whole lot of snow, or if you're climbing up the side of a mountain. You will always go at this speed if you're walking, or if you're holding down the right trigger or whatever button it is on PC. You will always be going at this speed. Doesn't matter if I'm climbing up this mountain back up to that thing up there. I will always go at this speed. You can climb up any part that is covered in snow. So that rock face right up over there, you will not be able to go up. I wish that your running speed was a little bit faster, but once again, this is a realistic walking and jogging speed. Moving on to the next one, we'll just go around this in order. Starting with the snowboarding, feels pretty much like most other snowboarding games that I've played. You use the right trigger or your PC equivalent to jump, and then you use both of the thumbsticks to do different tricks and try not to crash like I do so often. This is actually some of the best snowboarding that I've ever played. I will even say that this is potentially even better than the SSX snowboarding. Very simple, even if you don't tell someone the controls, they will figure it out very quickly. I even tried with my dad, who plays very few games whatsoever, and he was able to pick up these controls, and without me even telling him how to do anything, he kind of caught on after just a few minutes. So, yes, this is some of the best snowboarding controls. Let's go way back up here. I need to get somewhere high to show off the next one. Here we go. So, the amazing snowboarding controls kind of just tells you some of what you're going to be doing in the rest of the controls. They're all really, really good. I gotta get really high for this next one, because we're going to be checking out the wingsuit. Which, the wingsuit's exactly what you would think it's like. You fly kind of like a plane. The only thing is you're constantly falling. You use the right stick, well, the left stick, to tilt it left and right, up and down. Then you use the right stick to kind of jolt right and left. So it lets you turn harder. This is, it's okay. I would like some finer movement on it. For the most part, this is fine. The only problem is some of the challenges with this, you don't feel like you have enough maneuverability to actually go where they're telling you to go. So that could me just be, I could just be really bad with this, or there is actually a problem with it. I'm going to go with, I'm just really bad at this. I don't normally play with the wingsuit outside of the challenges, but, yeah, you just get to go down any part. Just make sure, let me go back over here. Just make sure that if you're, like, say, here, and you activate the wingsuit, you might just jump right like that. That'll happen quite often. Overall, the wingsuit, though, it feels great. The problem is most of your flights last for less than a couple minutes, so that's really a verticality problem, but that's not much of a problem. So far, snowboarding is amazing, wingsuit is amazing, now on to skiing. Really, I don't really know anything to compare this to, because I don't know if there's actually any other skiing games. I'm not personally a big fan of skiing, but this is essentially just a, in this game, the purpose that this serves is a more maneuverable if I could speak properly, a more maneuverable snowboard is essentially the purpose that this takes. When you're going down the mountain or the mountains on a snowboard in this game, you're kind of just going as fast as possible, and you can't really turn right or left with a whole bunch of accuracy and very quickly. This kind of fixes that, and you can really go right and left pretty far, pretty fast, and that really kind of helps out in quite a few challenges where you need to be able to go back and forth. And something that I found kind of funny, which I don't know how accurate this is, but someone's going to have to tell me. If you can quickly and accurately go down a hill backwards like this on skis, and how good you have to be at skiing to actually do that. So, let's try to... Nope. Okay, there we go. So, yep, skiing is also amazing. So far, the snowboarding is amazing. The wingsuit is pretty decent, but needs more maneuverability. The skiing is really, really good. Let's get on to the last one, which is paragliding. Now, this is one where I kind of have a bit of a problem. Which, let's go on to the paragliding. This one I have a bit of a problem with. First off, the paragliding races is essentially see how close you can stay to the mountain. Because, as you can see, the green arrows is kind of the amount of lift that you have. And this... The reason why I have a problem with paragliding might just be because I've not really... know much about it, but I personally don't really like paragliding, as there's not really much that you can do with this besides getting really close to the mountain and going up the mountain. And the stunts, how it says to hold the right trigger for stunts, essentially the only stunt that I have found that you can do is this. That's it. You can't even go around it the other way. So, say there's actually, like, a limit to how forward my character can go. Like, I can... This is about the only thing that I found that you can do with this. So, I'm quite bored whenever I'm paragliding in this game. Even that gets boring after a while. And, yeah, I just don't really find much of a purpose to paragliding in this game. There is quite a few challenges for it, and they are some of the harder challenges, but it's mostly just how close can you get to the mountain without crashing or landing. So for the final tally, let me just land this, or you know what? Let's go to a different mountain. We've been on Mont Blanc, which is in France. We've been on that for a while, so let's go down over here to this place that I can't even pronounce. Okay, so going through it again, the walking should be a little bit faster. The snowboarding is amazing. The wingsuit is okay. Skiing, also amazing. And paragliding, kind of boring. I've already gone through customization. Let's just go through the mountain, because I haven't done that yet, but I've shown it several times. So, you get the entirety of the world goes from, as you can see, there's a part on here, that whole like crossed out section to the right is a place that you can't go to. So, essentially, you get, let's see if I can get a good view of it. You get Mont Blanc and surrounding mountains. So, I don't know exactly how many mountains there are, but as you can see, you have like Mont Rosa, this place, Ost, or however you pronounce it. I'm really bad with names. You get actual Mont Blanc, then you get that place that we were just at, and then down the mountain a little bit. So essentially you get I think it's 9 peaks in total. So that's 3 across there, and then that's 1. Okay, so you get 7 peaks, 7 different mountains to go down. As you can tell, Mont Blanc is the tallest one, and the earlier ones are kind of not as tall. But yeah, essentially you get 7 mountains to go down, which is quite a few, and there's very little going through the same place multiple times. So that leads to a pretty good variety. As you can see, when we were up on top of the mountain, it was a bit more cloudy, and there was a bit less terrain of, like, rocks and everything. There wasn't any trees, and down here towards the bottom of the mountain, there is trees and a whole lot more terrain and obstacles to actually go through. So now to the final thing that I can really think of. Well, there's two things. The first one is the profile. As you can see, my global completion is at 58%, which is kind of a problem because I haven't played this game for that long. I put maybe 10 or so hours into this, 10, 15 hours into this, and so, yeah, I wish that there was some more that you could do with this. I'm already at max rank, which is level 25. That's your reputation. You unlock more things and more mountains as you go up. 25 is the max level. I got that way too early. There should be 35 to 40 levels in this game. The next thing is these six different things that you can do. You kind of really just get patches for them. I haven't found any other thing for it. You get helmets and some cosmetic gear for leveling them up higher. Essentially, you get points in each of these different things, and that levels up your main score. So, as you can see, I'm not, like, amazing in any of these things. The Freestyler and the Extreme Rider are kind of the bigger ones that I have, since those are both on level 4 out of 5. But yeah, this kind of just makes it overly complicated to have all your experience between six different things. Over here you can see the different challenges that I've completed. The weird thing about this is if those 59 gold medals also count towards the 69 silver medals and the 70 bronze medals. So 59 of these 70 bronze medals are challenges that I have gold medaled, which is kind of weird. Also, I've been around the mountain quite a bit, and it's kind of, I'm glad that I've only done 54% of the actual global exploration in this. So yeah, let's move on to the final thing. There's not really much in these other tabs, because I know you guys are going to want. You can group up with you and three other people to kind of have a group going around. Not really too much in that. That's kind of just there to group together to do these challenges, which this is the main focus of the game, is these challenges. Now, there's quite a few challenges that you will find. You just find them by going around the mountain and finding different peaks and going to different places. And you just go through and you can either activate them by going to the spot, or you can come into this menu and say, choose this one, and then you can click just X for PlayStation or A for Xbox or whatever your PC equivalent, and it will show you where the starting line for that is. So for my case, that mission that I picked was right there. And that's pretty much what you do to go through all these challenges. The skiing and snowboarding challenges are combined because you can use either of them to complete all these challenges. This is where there is the majority of the challenges are skiing and snowboarding. Next, you have wingsuit challenges, which there's not very many of, as you can see. Then next, there's paragliding challenges, which there's even less of. These are just more challenges that you can do. And then mountain stories is kind of the story of this game. There's not really much of a story of this game. It's more of just, oh, go and explore this mountain, do whatever you want. But these are actually kind of story bits that you can do in each of these different peaks and such. And there's quite a few of these. Then next, you can set up your own checkpoint races. I've only set up two, and then there's challenges that Ubisoft Annecy has set up. The problem that I found with these is that after 24 hours, your best score will just disappear. I don't know why, but I've already completed these two challenges, and as you can see, my best section right below the score to beat is empty. So if you want to have a really good score in that, just remember that you're going to have to play that several times over again. So yeah, that's pretty much everything to Steep. If you like what you've seen, you might need to go check out some other people if you want to do more than just snowboarding in this game, because that's mostly what I've shown off. You might want to look up some more gameplay, but yeah, if this is something interesting to you, I would recommend picking this up on a sale. There's just that timed obsolescence is just a big downside for this. The always online DRM, like, if you aren't connected to the internet, well, I'm sorry, there's no way that you're even going to be able to play this. That's mainly the big problem that I have with this, because there will come a point where this game just doesn't work anymore, and that is a pretty big problem for me. I would recommend picking this up on a sale. I would be willing to pay, $35 to $40 for this. It's kind of a catch-22. I want people to pick this up, so that the servers will stay on longer, but the reason why I don't want people to pick this up is because the servers won't stay on forever. If they do happen to ever switch it out so that it's, say, peer-to-peer, or it's not always online DRM, well, then I would recommend paying $45+ for this, but you're going to get about 30 hours of snowboarding and... Well, snowboarding and paragliding and skiing and wingsuit jumps. So pretty much whatever you would pay for that, I recommend a sale. Just because this game's not going to last forever. So that is it for this review. I know that I can get a little scattered in these live reviews. My next one will not be another live review. I don't plan on having a live review for a while, but yeah, that is it for this. Remember, I'm Ryan from Blue to Gaming. My next video should be another review of a older PC game that came out about a year and a half ago. So that will be it for this. Remember, I'm Ryan from Blue to Gaming. I'll see you guys in the next one.